Well, it's not Christmas. It's a few days after Christmas. It's Monday. Christmas was on Friday. But we didn't have any snow on Friday, and for that was for the first time since I've lived here. We didn't have any snow on Christmas morning. So being as how I'm all by myself, just me and Sabrina, she's around here somewhere. I knew it was supposed to snow on Monday, so I decided to wait till Monday to have Christmas. Well, it's Monday, and we have snow. So for me, it's Christmas. Now Sabrina's already got one of her presents. Didn't she? Yeah, look at that big bone. That's a nice big femur, isn't it? Yeah, she loves it. And it was all white a little while ago. But not anymore. It's kind of warm and the snow is melting already. It was supposed to be a lot more. It was supposed to snow all day and it's spitting right now, but not enough. Like I said, it's warm. So there's the DeVille in all her glory. First thing I'm going to do to that is unflip the axle. That's a very dangerous thing to do. Don't ever do that. If you get a trailer with a flipped axle, unflip it. I'll show you how. Pretty easy. So, still kind of white back here. That right there, that's going to be the Mobile Tech trailer. I'm going to design that trailer completely on my own. And if you stick with me, you'll get to see that one also. We have a 63 Travelease. It's been waiting patiently. I doubt anything's going to happen to that before summer. I've got to rebuild this Dyco. I rebuilt it once, now I got to rebuild it again because it's falling apart in the upper corners up there. I haven't done anything to the boat yet, and I haven't done anything to this DeVille. This is another DeVille. Actually a copy, a Canadian copy, but it is a DeVille. So it's getting a little breezy and now it's finally getting cold too. Let's mosey on inside the shop and see what's going on in there. Oh, getting warm in here. Good. Alrighty. I'm working on the 59. What we're doing is sanding the inside down, scraping it, sanding it. There are no lights in here. I guess I'll have to get some light on the subject so you can see. All right, there's some light. As you can see, the ceiling is almost completely done as far as sanding is concerned. Might be a little out of focus because of the lack of light. But what we're going to do is we're going to shellac it all like this with amber shellac, which I have a lot of that done already. So we're getting that done. Now, once the ceiling is shellacked, then we'll go for the walls and the side cabinets and the kitchen cabinet. When the kitchen cabinet is done and the side walls are done, I'll move that over to its living place right here and fasten it. Of course, I'll fix that wheel well first. That wheel well is the reason that so much damage was caused to this trailer when a tire exploded. And I've talked about that in previous earlier videos. Won't go into it today, but yeah. A blowout in your wheel can be devastating to your trailer. In this one, it lost the entire axle, which did a lot of damage. Anyway, as you can see, we're making progress. Now right there, leaning against the wall, that is the floor framing for the Jewel. Now the Jewel is a project trailer for my classes. As most of you know, I hold classes online every Tuesday evening, and one of the things we do in those classes is we're building this Jewel. It's a 1954 Jewel. here's some photos of what it used to look like. And we took it all the way down to the axle. And now we're rebuilding it. So if you want to see that build, you got to be a member of my class. Again, those are held every Tuesday evening, live online. I do a streaming 2-hour or more video every Tuesday evening for my patrons. Now, moving on to the thing that I'm most happiest with is the 48 main line. And a lot of you who have been following the metal work on this trailer, or the entire trailer, know that I had some problems with it. And when we got to the roof, we had major buckling problems. And I had to solve those problems. Took a few months, but I finally got it done, and now we can move on and finish the trailer. So I'd like to go ahead and run you through a brief description of what happened. As you saw in the previous videos, if you watched them, we had taken the entire roof, which we strapped down on both ends, and I did this with advice from somebody that's been doing this longer than I have. It turned out not to work out on this trailer though. But anyway, the roof goes from just below the front windows here to just below the rear window in the back. And as a result, it's a very, very long roof. I mean, this is a, you know, it's a 16-17 foot trailer as it is. So when you add the front wall and the rear wall, that's a pretty long roof. That's 20 feet of roof. So that's the first problem. The main problem that I discovered with this trailer, and I knew it existed because when I did the wrap for the paneling, I saw this. When I was working on the cabinets inside, I saw this. There are two floor-to-ceiling cabinets near the bed. And the top of those cabinets are shaped like this at an angle, making a crown on the roof. The rest of the cabinets, the corner cabinet that is over the sink, has the same crown to it, although because it's a smaller cabinet, it's smaller, but it shows the crown. And I thought back then, this could be a problem, because metal doesn't like to bend in two directions at once. It can be formed like that with pressure, but not this metal that we're working with, and I have no machines like that. So I thought it might be a problem. Well, we strapped down the roof, as you saw, and I marked all the vents and the windows and everything in it that needed to be cut out. And then we disconnected it from the straps and rolled it out into the front driveway on my two tables, my $100 rolling workbenches, which was long enough to handle it. And, you know, when put end to end and everything, they're 16 feet, so with a little space in the middle, it worked out fine. And I made my cutouts, and I put all that on video. And then we rolled it back up inside onto the roof and replaced it. Okay? Well, then I went ahead and fastened down the front and the rear just exactly the way it was done originally. And these are big quarter inch head type twisty nails. So there's a piece of framework behind here on the inside. That's where all the framing is. And I nailed it all down on both ends. I had it all nice and tight. It looked like everything was going to lay down nice, and all I had to do was put the trim on. That's when we started running into problems. Now on this trailer, normally when we have J-rail, we start at the middle of the top and work out in both directions and down. But on this trailer, because of the fact that it's all flat metal, and because we're using corner cap rail instead of, or also known as top edge molding, we decided to start at the bottom and work our way up. And in doing so, as we got closer and closer to the top, it was getting harder and harder to get the corner cap rail on without buckling. And I thought, well, maybe I need to trim the top a little bit more. So I took it down and trimmed it more and put it back up. And we still had the buckling problem as we got up both ends of the trailer with the trim. And I could not for the life of me figure out what was going on. Now, there's something else wrong with this trailer, and it comes from the factory design. When they designed this trailer, they ran all the electrical on the very top, unprotected, with metal over it. And I didn't like that idea. It seems dangerous to me. So what I did was I went ahead and put quarter-inch strips of plywood on both sides of the wirings to protect it, along with I put the vapor barrier on top of that, and that's caught was causing the metal to be round even more, because now it has, it's crowning up even higher above the wires and above where the cabinets are round on top. So I realized I was going to have to get rid of that plywood right off the bat and just put an extra layer of vapor barrier in hopes to protect the wiring against the top metal, which is riding right on top of it. See, that looks dangerous to me. Eventually, I think it could wear through and short out the wiring. So I did that. I removed the roof again and got rid of the plywood, put it back on, and we still had buckling problems. No matter what I did, this trailer, the metal was buckling, especially in the rear where those floor-to-ceiling cabinets are. Let me just show you those real quick. All right. I don't have any power in here, so I'll have to use these lights, but they work fine. And I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. The best place to look is right over here, okay? And you can see how, I don't have any hands, but the wood trim that you see there is wider on the right than it is on the left. Now that's just not just a camera angle, it is. So it gets, this cabinet gets higher as it gets towards the middle. The other one does this, jeez, oh, I'm having things crash. The other side does the same thing, only you can't see as much of it because all the cabinets here and the trim is in the way, but it does the same thing. And then right behind it, of course, in a more exaggerated view, you can see it wider on the right than it is on the left because, of course, now we're starting the radius down. With this angle here, because of the radius going towards the rear of the trailer, and this angle right here, because of the crown on the cabinet, you have metal going in two different directions as far as trying to bend is concerned. You can't do that, especially with this thick 030 metal. It's not going to do it. It just won't bend in two different directions. So as a result, you end up with a buckle that keeps traveling towards the center of the trailer from both ends, and there's nothing that can be done about it. So, after a few months of back and forth and up and down with the metal and trying everything I could possibly think of in order to fix this problem, I finally came to the realization of the fact that it's unfixable in its current state. One of the main problems that was causing this buckling was the fact that these cabinets here on both sides are round in two different directions. So I don't know how you're going to fix something like that, and I don't know how they did it back in the 40s. I have no idea how they took care of this problem. The only way I could see to fix it was to cut the roof here and in the same place over here, up past the top of the radius where it wouldn't be seen from either the front or the rear, and replace it with new metal. But another problem comes into play here. Every 4 feet, the roofs of today are not solid roofs. They're not solid metal. They're made in 4 foot pieces with an acme seam, is what it's called, an acme seam lock. And I show what those are and how they're made in my video, which I'll put a link up here. Fabricating a new metal roof, which I filmed the process at Steve Loomis's shop. And the reason I filmed that that video was to prove to everyone that the acme seams don't leak. There's no need to goop them. That's not where they leak. They leak in other places, especially when there's vent holes. So the putty tape dries up after a certain amount of years and water starts getting in there That's where they leak. The reason people think it's the seams that are leaking is it's the most obvious thing to them at first sight, number one. And number two, water tends to travel to the nearest place where it can get downhill, where it can get out. And it always, you know, it always shows coming out somewhere else than where it's really, where the leak really is. So usually the seams of the plywood is, of the paneling, is where it starts coming out at first. They see water dripping there, they see water damage there. That's because where the most water settles. And so they think that the seam's leaking, and it's not so. It's coming from somewhere else, usually a vent, or the J-rail, if there's J-rail, or the corner cap mold, if there's corner cap. And it's just coming out at the seams of the paneling. That's where they first see it. Of course, it's not coming out there because of that. It's coming out there because it's the first opening that the water sees. Following gravity. Anyway, I could not use an Acme seam over this combination bend because an Acme seam is made out of very strong metal. I think it's even steel. I don't think it's aluminum. It may be aluminum, but it's very strong metal and it doesn't bend very easily. So I had to have metal that would not have it to have a seam in it, which meant I had to find metal that was wider than 8 feet for the width and longer, whatever length I needed to cover the span without a seam. That metal is not easy to find. Matter of fact, the only place you can find it is from a trucker roofing company, a place where they repair or build trailers, tractor trailers for big semis. Those semi trailers are either 8 or 10 feet wide or somewhere in between, and you can buy roof coils that run any length you want. Whatever, you know, they have 40-foot trailers, 43-foot trailers, 30-foot trailers, whatever length you want. So I had to order metal from a trucking company over in Reno that I found, Intercontinental Metals. And they sold me a piece of metal, brand new, for the top of this trailer. Now it doesn't match this metal, but I don't care because it's on top. Nobody's ever going to see it. It's going to get clear coated along with this metal, and that'll make it look a little more like this metal does, but it'll still probably stand out. But it's on top, so who cares? I don't care. I have to get this trailer done and back to its owner. She's 89 years old, and she's not getting any younger. And she has managed to stay alive through all this COVID thing this year. So I got to get this trailer back to her. I was hoping to have it back to her last spring. It didn't happen. There again, folks, forget about deadlines. Even for the best of us, and I consider myself fairly good at this, deadlines just never work out. All they do is shorten your life, your lifespan, because of stress. So I am going to go ahead and show you what the roof looks like now. It has two seams that look just like these right here, and it is watertight. I sealed it with a half inch wide putty tape, and it's not the kind of putty tape you're used to. It's not the dry kind. This never dries out. It's more rubbery, and it's actually butyl tape. It's not putty tape. So half inch wide, 16th of an inch thick. Let me show you what that looks like. All right, here's the way that stuff comes. And as you can see, there's no gray crinkly paper, and it's kind of smooth looking, and it's sticky. It will stick. So when you put this on, it's not coming apart. So both seams up there are sealed with that stuff. There's no way it's ever gonna leak. It'll be fine. There's no way it'll ever come apart because it's got twisty nails, 1-inch twisty nails with 1/4-inch heads every 2.5 inches. So now let me show you what it looks like, because I know that's what you're waiting to see. There it is. See, it doesn't look bad. It's just not shiny yet because the new stuff has the clear coat on it, which is gonna get 2 more coats of clear coat, and you know, the regular stuff that I used on this trailer. And this new piece does not. It's raw aluminum. So it's a little dirty. I mean, I need to clean up all the red powder from the chalk lines and everything, but as you can see, that's well sealed in both areas. It's not going to come apart. And also, you can see here where the buckling was beginning, And I couldn't get rid of all of it, but it's above the view line where you can see. As you're looking up at the trailer, all you see is nice, pretty stuff. And then right there is where the buckling started. I spread it out over the width of the trailer to get rid of it. And then it's nice and smooth all the way up front and all the way down. So I'm not 100% happy with the way it came out because of that little bit of buckling in the rear. But you can't see it. It's sealed. There's nothing else that we can do with it. I've worked on it for over 2 months trying to get rid of the buckle completely and just cannot do it. And I know you're going to give me, well, Larry, why don't you do this? Larry, why don't you do that? Larry, have you thought of this? I thought of everything. There's nothing I can do. Before I had the wrap on it, I was considering flattening out the cabinets because I knew it was going to cause a problem. But I thought to myself, I've had trailers like the 66 Super Shasta that are crowned on purpose like that. Never had a problem with them. But this is different for some reason. It's just the two different bends are too close to each other. And the Shasta, it was a toaster. So it's flat on top, flat on the back, flat on the rear. You don't have corresponding problems with two different bends running into each other. So it's not a problem with those because they're toasters. And every other roof that I've ever done, and I've done a lot of them, came out perfect. So this one, it's just going to have to live like that, folks. All the people that built this trailer are dead, so I can't ask them how they fixed it. It's a 1948. That's just all there is to it. Nothing I can do about it. Alrighty, well, that's the update. And the final update for the year 2020. I've got a lot of good stuff coming up in the future. We're working on the Jewel. I'm going to travel with that trailer and run around the countryside next spring, beginning next spring, on my tour. And I'm going to visit my viewers and patrons all over the country. Now, this won't happen all in one trip. It's going to be split up amongst a bunch of different trips. And we don't know what's happening with the economy, the government, the COVID, or anything right now. The year 2020, I don't believe, is going to end on December 31st. I honestly don't believe that. I don't think we're going to see the year 2021 as a new year. I have the funny feeling it's going to just be 2020 continued until certain things change. So let's wait and see what happens before I call it the end of 2020. But supposedly, this is the last public video before the end of the year. I'm not even going to celebrate New Year's. I waited till today to celebrate Christmas because I wanted snow. It's the first time since I've lived here that we didn't have snow on Christmas Day. So knowing there was snow coming, I decided to wait till today to celebrate Christmas and open up my packages. And the packages that I have to open are all from viewers and patrons. So I want to thank all you nice folks for that, for those packages. Without you, I would have no Christmas whatsoever. It'd just be me and the dog. And of course, as you saw, I already gave her her Christmas present, but there is one waiting in this little pile over here. So now I'm going to go ahead and open these presents right in front of you. First, I'm going to get rid of this jacket because it's finally warmed up in here. Maybe the heater will even go off. I don't know. Well, the heater's still going. All right. Let's see here. My dog is in my way. She's wanting loving and stuff. And, you know, she's right here in my way, of course. Well, let's see what we got here. As you can see, I got my little tree here. I haven't had a tree in years. Stop it. Jeez, give me a chance. Got my little tree, and first off, you'll notice the one ornament on it is a cute little camper ornament, a Can-Am camper. It says Happy Camper on the back, and it's cool. So thank you for that. That was sent to me by Peggy Chance. I want to thank you, Peggy. And along with that little camper trailer ornament there, came this package with a note in it. And let's see here. Enjoy the world's most legendary chocolate, specially selected for you. And it's got, you know, customer care stuff. It's got a note. Merry Christmas, Larry. Thank you for sharing your trailer wisdom earned by making mistakes so we don't have to. Peggy Chance with the 64 Sarascotti Sportsman. Thank you, Peggy Chance, for the ornament and for the chocolate. How did you know I was a chocolate lover? And I have to watch that because I'm lactose intolerant. Some chocolates have more milk in them than others. And usually around this time of year, I just go ahead and suffer with it. I get a big rash starting at my ears and going all the way down to my knees when I get too much lactose in me. And by the way, it took me 3 years to figure that one out because my doctors were so stupid, they couldn't figure it out. So when chocolate season arrives, I just go ahead and suffer through it. And I take Benadryl. That helps with it. Oh, look at this. Oh, that was a big box. Assorted Godiva trussels. I've had trussels once before in my life. Boy, are they good. I've noticed that dark chocolate doesn't affect me as much as any other chocolate. So there we go. Dark milk chocolate truffles. All right, well, maybe that means I won't get the rash too bad, but it'll be worth it because I love chocolate. There you go. Thank you so much, Piggy. And gosh, I can even hang that in the tree, I guess. It might make the tree fall. Yeah, it's not going to work. But I'll put it up there by the tree, okay? Put it right under the box there. I mean, right under the trailer. And then also, I have one here from Laura. She's another one of my patrons. And I've already been using this. She picked this, she wanted to see my wish list. And I didn't know you could publish a wish list. I'm not a beggar, so I don't, you know, I don't go much for publishing, you know, begging for money and stuff. But she looked at my wish list and this was on there and I've been needing one of these for a long time. This is a video lamp and it works really good. I've actually used it in a couple of the classes now. You can see that really works good there. Almost too bright, but I can adjust the brightness and the color of the light. So it came with filters and everything. And as you can see, I can turn that way down or turn it way up, and I can change the frequency also of the light. So I'm learning about that now, lighting. So thank you, Laura. Thank you so much for that. It's something I really needed. It's been on my wish list for a while and I haven't really been able to afford it, certain things, just because, well, if I don't need them right now to survive, I just don't bother with it. All right, now I'll get a couple other things out of the way here. I also got from Kay Hillier, another one of my wonderful patrons, a $25 Amazon gift card. So thank you for that, and I've already spent it. I went online and I spent it on something else that I need that I just didn't see as being important enough to reach into my money and take money away from my house and stuff to buy for myself. So I'll share that with you. Here's what I got on Amazon. Alrighty, let's see what else we got here. Now this, I've already dug into it because I can't let food sit around. The food that I eat that I eat all the time is pretty bland because my heart condition. I have coronary artery disease that I've been fighting since 2004. In 04, February of 04, I had a heart attack, and it was the left descending coronary artery, which they call the Widowmaker. They call it the Widowmaker because it normally kills people. I was very lucky that I had been taking large doses of aspirin at the time that it happened. If not, I would have been dead before my knees hit the ground from what the doctor told me. And I actually saw somebody die like that from the same exact thing. So, around this time of year, there's all kinds of really good tasting food out there to eat. And I kind of tend to get away from my diet, but as long as I, you know, everything in moderation, I don't do it all the time, I can keep my arteries clean. This had fine sausage in it, It's from Usinger's, and it's got crackers and different kinds of sausage and different kinds of cheese, and even a knife to cut the cheese with, a serrated knife. And it's not a low quality knife. It's got Usinger's name on there and everything. So that's pretty cool. I've already eaten half of it, but there was no note, so I don't know who sent this. I don't know if it was a patron or a viewer, but whoever you were, thank you. The thought is all I really need. I appreciate it that you're thinking of me. Thank you so much. Alrighty, let's see here. Get my knife. We'll open another box. Let's see what's in here. And this is from Elon Furpo, who is another one of my students, my lovely students. And let's go ahead and see what Elon decided to send me here. I sharpened my knife before this, but needed it anyway. Let's see what's in here. Oh, a present. Oh, and something else. Okay. To Larry from Elon. Well, first, we're going to look at this. This is to Sabrina from Elon. It's a little hammer shaped in the shape of a dog bone. Okay, now, Sabrina, you finally get to get in on the act. So let's get you, if I can get this stupid tripod to work. There we go. Let's go ahead and get you in on the act and give you your, I'll open it for you. And she's going to eat this in about 30 seconds. I messed up with the knot, so have to do that. But thank you, Elon. My old dog. Sabrina thanks you. And I'm going to give this to her in pieces, because if I give it to her like this, it's going to be gone in 20 seconds, 15 seconds. So I'll give it to her in pieces, if I can break it. Yeah. There's a big hunk right there. Sabrina says thank you. All right, so she'll get more of that later. Alrighty, so let's see what I got from Elon. And save that, I guess. Thinking I could put it on her head, but the sticky's gone. So let's just see. Can I open this one without messing it up? Yes, I can. Okay. Let's just go ahead and see. Oh, God. My favorite chocolate of all. Boy, I'm glad I waited, because this would be gone. This would be gone. I got another package, one from my mortgage holders, the greatest people in the world. They're like family to me, and they treat me like family. The people I bought this place from, they're just wonderful people, the King family. And so they hold the papers on this house, and I pay them, and they're wonderful people. And they sent me a package with a bunch of different kinds of food in it. And I'm still working on the zucchini bread, which is really good. That's in the house. But it had a small amount of fudge chocolate with it. And I couldn't just sit there and look at it. I had to eat it. So this is fudge chocolate made in Humboldt County. Allie's Confections. Allie's Confections. So it must be homemade. And there's like, oh, it looks like at least, yeah, there's six huge squares of chocolate fudge in there. I would eat one right now, but I'm going to wait. And I'm really going to try and make this last more than a day. But if I don't, I'll break out in a horrible rash anyway. Thank you so much for that, Elon. Old-fashioned chocolate fudge with walnuts. I love it with walnuts. That's great. Walnuts give you the idea that it might even be healthy for you. All right, what's in here? Who's it from? This is from Sandra K. Johnson. She's another one from California. And I feel sorry for people in California. They've been all locked down. Here in Nevada, a lot of our counties are just telling the governor to go flip himself. Let's put it that way. Our sheriffs are wonderful people. We support our local police, our sheriff's department, and our Nevada Highway Patrol. 100%, because they're great people who go out there and risk their lives daily for us. So we support our sheriffs, and because of that, They're supporting us. They're not bothering, and they told the governor this, they're not bothering to enforce anything. And people who are coming in from OSHA, we require them, and the sheriffs require them to, if they come in from out of town, they have to quarantine themselves for 14 days before they can go into any business. And so the sheriff nicely offers their jail for quarantine for that 14 days. If they turn it down, they can't come into any businesses. They call that a local economic emergency. What do we got in here? Let's see. Well, we got a card. So let's see what the card looks like. I keep these cards, by the way, from year to year when I get them. I got a lot of cards and stuff last year from my viewers and patrons. Santa Claus, one reindeer. It must be Rudolph because he's got a red nose. Well, economics, you know, I had to cut down the reindeer flock, but herd, I guess. Cut down the reindeer herd to save money. Hope your holidays are filled with fun. Thank you for all you do to help. You are a lifesaver. Aaron and Sandra Johnson. Well, thank you guys for thinking of me. I love it. Just, you're wonderful, beautiful people. I don't do this for the thanks. I do it because I want to see people have fun. I know they struggle. And I saw so many people on YouTube doing it wrong that, well, actually, when I started, I saw nobody on YouTube doing it at all. I was the first. But over the years, I see so many people showing you how to do it the wrong way that I have to stay out in front of them and show you the right way. So let's see what you sent me. Ah, nuts. Pistachios from Cephalon Farms. Okay, dry roasted with sea salt. Oh, good, sea salt, yeah. Because I also watch my salt intake, again, because of my heart. And I use Himalayan pink salt or sea salt. So you gotta have salt. So even if it's bad for you, for certain things, you still have to have it. There's something else in here. What is this? Let's see. Must be food. More pistachios, extra large. Gotta have the extra large ones. Those are important. Okay, I gotta change this battery too because it's starting to flash at me. So let's do that. Well, the heater finally turned off, so it must be 70 degrees in here. When I'm working, I run it at 60 degrees, but I'm not working right now, so. All right, I don't want to hurt anything inside here, so I'll be careful. This is from, where is it from? Oh, Jackie Duty, oh yeah. She gave me, last year, she sent me a calendar from 1954. It's a real calendar that was used, and the last page is still on it from December of 1954. And there's all kinds of phone numbers written on it, so it must have been a calendar that hung next to a phone on a wall. I know a lot of you younger people have no idea what I'm talking about. Phone on the wall? Why would you put your cell phone on the wall? We didn't have cell phones back then. We had what were known as rotary dial phones. And in 1954, a lot of people still didn't, they didn't even have rotary dial phones. A lot of them had party lines. And you had to call the operator by, you know, tapping on the hang-up button thing, the hanger-upper thing where the receiver hung. You had to tap on that to get the operator's attention, and then she would connect you with whoever you wanted. So that's the way it used to work. So a lot of phones were hanging on the wall. It might have even been in a bar somewhere, hanging on the wall next to a payphone. Who knows? Because there's lots of phone numbers written on the calendar. And, of course, back then we didn't use but five numbers. In 1954, I believe it was either five or seven numbers. It started out with the telephone system as four numbers, went to five numbers, then seven numbers as more and more people got telephones. And now we use, what is it, nine digits, something like that. So it includes area code. Anyway, let's see what's in here. There's a card, so we'll start with that. Let me get it out of here. And a note. So let's look at the card first. Yeah, Jackie's been with me for a while. Her and Kevin built such a good, beautiful trailer. And here's a picture of it. With it, they went camping in their trailer this year. Last year they got their diploma from the Mobile Tech School of Vintage Trailer Restoral. All my students, when they graduate, which means when they finish their trailer, they get a diploma that they can hang proudly on the wall of the trailer or in their house, whatever. And I tell them to take a picture out in front of your trailer with the diploma, and I'll put you in my Canned Ham Hall of Fame, which I just started on my website. Go to my website, cannedhamtrailers.com, and look for the Hall of Fame, and you'll see. There's only 6 or 7 people on there now, and there's been plenty more that have graduated, but not everybody sends me a picture. And you got to send me that photo with you and your diploma in order to get the get yourself in the Hall of Fame. So, it's the most wonderful time of year, isn't it though? Oh my God, oh, there's money in there. Oh, Jackie, you don't need to send me money. It's appreciated, but it'll probably just go for something stupid like food or my mortgage payment or something, but thank you so much. I don't want to show that. But on the inside it says, see what I mean? Okay, I showed you. But thank you so much, Jackie, for that. You're just wonderful. You and Kevin both. Merry Christmas to both of you. And let's see what... oops, come here, you. I don't want to lose that. Put that here. It's the most wonderful time of year. Larry, greetings from North Carolina. Jackie picked this book up in Texas at a Bucky's travel store. I've heard of that. I've heard of Bucky's. Her love of old campers drew her to it. This last weekend we were doing our now annual Christmas trip, and we're taking a good look at it. You came up, of course, because without your videos and help, we would never have completed the sweet little camper we call Jorga, or maybe it's Horga. It's J-O-R-G-A. So in the spirit of Christmas, we decided to get you a copy and send it along with a token of our gratitude. Oh, makes me feel good. We hope that things are going well in your life and hope that we will see you on the road someday. Best wishes and Merry Christmas, Kevin and Jackie Duty. I can't wait to get to North Carolina, Jackie and Kevin, because I hear so many good things about it. I will get there eventually. And we will meet up in person, and I definitely can't wait to actually see your camper in person. So thank you very much. Let's go ahead and take a look at the book now and see this book that they're talking about. And I'll add this to my collection of vintage travel trailer books, because I have a collection of those. This will be one of the bigger ones, if I can ever get it out of the packaging. Do it. Woo. Vintage camper trailers. Thank you so much for that. Oh man, let's see. Oh, I know these people. Cole and Caroline Lassinola. These are the people that own the magazine, Vintage Camper Trailer Magazine. Now there's two magazines. There's the original Vintage Trailer Magazine, and then there's these guys, Vintage Trailer Camper Magazine. And this should be filled with all kinds of pictures that they've probably had in, the photos of stuff that they've had in their at their rallies. They have 3 rallies, I believe it is, per year. And this is a 47 Aeroflight right here that I opened up to. I've seen this trailer. I know this man. John and Phyllis Green, I know them. I know a lot of the people who are regulars. We call them circuit trailers that make all the different rallies all over the country all the time. And I remember going into that trailer, and I have it on my last video where I did Hot August Nights, the Hot August Nights rally in Sparks in Reno. So, oh, and look at here. This trailer, doesn't that look a lot like the one I'm working on right now, this one behind me, the main line? It's not a main line, but it's built kind of the same way, same materials and stuff, same look. So that'll be great to go through. I know that I'll probably see in there, I may even see one of my trailers if I look through this entire book. So we'll just have to take a look and see. But yeah, lots of neat trailers in here to look at and the story behind them. So thank you so much for that, Jackie and Kevin Duty. I have one more, and the tree is sitting on it, so let's go ahead and open that. Let's just see what's in here. Shipped with care. There's my knife. Oh, this is from Vintage Trailer Supply. Oh, I think I know what this is. This isn't a Christmas present. It's an order. I forgot about it. I had ordered, and they didn't get here in time, I had ordered a globe and some of these mantles, the hard mantles and stuff. I wanted to see what they look like and how they work. So I bought stuff like that. And I was hoping it would get here in time for last week's class when we went into propane, but it didn't. So I wonder if it's short anything. Nope, everything looks like it should be here. So, all right, well, Steve at Vintage Trailer Supply, thank you for getting that to me a little late, but better late than never, I suppose. So that's it. The heater came back on. Sabrina is finally happy over there in her corner looking at me. She's just waiting for me to give her some more of this because I know she really liked that. Alrighty, so this is the last video of this year, and I know it's not a very exciting one, but life has not been all that exciting lately until I got the roof on this thing finally, and that made the whole year for me. There's not that much left to do on it now. I've got a couple more doors, cabinet doors, to refinish in there, and then I've got to rebuild the 2-inch blinds, vintage blinds that go on all the windows, and hang those, hang the curtains, polish the floor, hook up the lights, the heater vent, you know, paint the propane tank and the tongue. There's not a lot left to do. It's all little stuff. So I'll keep you abreast of all that in the coming videos and in the coming year. And we'll get this thing delivered to Anita. And when I do that, I'm going to video the look on her face, because I think we're all going to get a kick out of that. So remember, she's owned this trailer from the beginning. Her father bought this trailer when she was 17 years old, and she still has it. And she has the car that another patron of mine who finished his trailer in my class, Kevin Hensley, actually had his hands on the tow vehicle and restored that. So, because the original guy, Dave, who was supposed to restore the car, and he's the one that called me and contracted me to do this trailer, he died right after they got he had a heart attack like mine, but it killed him. Died right there on the spot. And here the whole car was in pieces, and they just got all the chrome back, and now it was a basket case. So they had to find somebody in a hurry to finish that. So I'll keep you up to date on all the finishing ups. Projects of the main line and getting the 59 Shasta finished, and then it's back to the I'll be working, I'm constantly working on the Jewel, and that again is my class project. And if any of you feel like expanding your education beyond what you see of my videos on YouTube, you're welcome to join the class. There'll be a link at the end of this video, a Patreon link. Just follow that for more information on how to sign up. So from the bottom of my heart, I say Merry Christmas to all you wonderful people who watch my videos. I'm tickled pink that I'm able to bring you the information that I bring you. I'm tickled pink to be able to make the steaks so that you don't have to. So with that, until next time and until next year, this is Mobile Tech Larry from CanhamTrailers.com signing off, and again wishing you all a very Merry Christmas. You want some more of this, don't you? You want some more of this, don't you? No, 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 not all of it. Here, break it. I'll give you a little piece. There you go. Ooh. Boy, that looks pretty good inside. Tastes kind of bland. Here you go.
Here you go. Merry Christmas.